Good morning once again. My name is Lloyd Jackson. I'm the Director of Communications for the Wayne County Department of Health, Veterans, and Community Wellness, and I'm your MC throughout the day, and I'm thanking you once again for being here, hoping you're enjoying yourself so far. We've had some good discussions, and we're going to continue those good discussions right now. And the discussion is health equity in all policies, working together for safe, accessible infrastructure for Flint. The moderator today will be Dr. Nicolette Louis Saint, who serves Healthcare Ready as the Director of Programming. In this role, she leads all projects and congressional outreach on healthcare preparedness throughout the United States, coordinates with public health and private healthcare decision makers, and contributes to emergency responses during disasters and events. Prior to this position, Dr. Louis Saint served as a Foreign Affairs Officer at the U.S. Department of State and the Bureau of Economic and Business Affairs. As lead officer for health, intellectual property, and trade issues, she advised the state's department's leadership on issues related to public health, technology transfer, and biotechnology. During the height of the Ebola epidemic in 2014, Dr. Louis Saint served as the senior advisor to Ambassador Nancy J. Powell and Ambassador Stephen Browning, the State Department's special coordinators for Ebola. Dr. Louis Saint holds bachelor's of science degrees in chemical engineering and biological sciences from Carnegie Mellon University. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Nicolette Louis Saint.
Good morning, everyone. It truly is an honor to be here. I want to thank the organizers. I know that's been a lot of hard work that's gone into coordinating this, and we really appreciate all of the work and the time that you've put into coordinating such a wonderful conference. For the next hour or so, we're really going to turn our attention to thinking about how health equity plays a role in disasters. In particular, looking at the Flint water crisis and what happens at the intersection of environmental justice and public health in the context of disasters. When I think about disasters as somebody who does emergency preparedness and response, I think about all sorts of events. I think about uprisings and what that means for public health. I think about failures in infrastructure, whether that comes from a hurricane or a water crisis or a snowstorm. It can be any of those things, any of those events can and often do have disproportionate effects in health outcomes for especially people of color. In the United States, we've seen Hurricane Sandy have significant effects on people of color, on the elderly, on pregnant women in terms of delivery of care, continuity of care. We've seen Hurricane Katrina result in both permanent displacement of individuals and the breakdown of community, as well as a number of negative public health effects. And so today, I'm really, really glad to be here with this really interesting panel. But we're going to be looking specifically at the Flint water crisis and the lessons learned. And part of the reason that we are doing this is because it was Flint today, but it could be Baltimore tomorrow. It could be Pittsburgh. It could be a number of cities. And it really does come down to questions about how we are thinking about the role of infrastructure. Both whether it's physical infrastructure, how we dedicate personnel, resources, funding towards making sure that our communities are protected, and also what happens when those provisions fail. What happens to those communities when those safeguards that are in place are no longer sufficient. So I'm going to start on my far left. And I'd like for all of the panelists to just introduce themselves and just give a few seconds, a minute or so, about kind of how you come to this issue and your experience.
I'm Deborah Verholden. I first came to this group through the Baltimore Equity Matters team, so it's always, so when Michael Scott says newcomers here, I hope I'm not included in that group. But I'm really happy to be here. I actually left Baltimore. I took a position at Michigan State University in their new public health division back in January, and that division started out of the city and the Mott Foundation and the community and Michigan State and other stakeholders really understanding that there were so many structural deficits and public health challenges in Flint and so many issues around equity that they really had to come together and create a call for action. So the division that I'm in actually predated what we call the water crisis, and there's lots of nomenclature I could use to describe that, but I'll stick with that language for the purposes of this meeting. But I came there to join a group of very elite public health professionals to bring this conversation and both solutions around equity. To that end, I'm really proud to serve with a lot of the folks here on what we just created, the Flint Center for Health Equity Solutions, with funding from the National Institute of Minority Health and Health Disparities. And I hope throughout the course of this meeting that myself and our other Flint partners can get more related to some of you all and the work that you're doing.
Good morning. My name is Yvonne Lewis, and I am a resident of Flint, Michigan. Lived there now for 40 years. And so to ask me why I'm here for the water crisis, I guess, because it's my lived experience. I have, I came into public health accidentally. My initial academic degree was in business administration, and I spent 15 years working in corporate America until I found out that wasn't what I wanted to do, and stumbled because of some work my father decided he wanted to do as a minister in a community to work on the issue of crack cocaine and the infant mortality epidemic. Realizing that I didn't have that background because I was seated at the table with academicians and health professionals. And when asked about my credentials, I was summarily dismissed from the table because I did not have a health background. So that sent me back to school as a non-traditional student to Michigan State, University of Michigan, Flint, to obtain a bachelor's degree in clinical community psychology, because I felt that there was some kind of psychology, something at work in the community that continued to create and keep what we were experiencing in place. And so then the rest is history. I've been in Flint now for this length of time. What's interesting to me, even with the conversation we had today, and I'll close with my concept, because I think there's a contextual perspective that is often missed when this story is told. And I understand that place matters, but history also matters. Culture also matters. And I had to write down so I wouldn't forget. Beliefs and understandings and misunderstandings matter. And ultimately, trust matters. And where there is no trust, no matter what is done, there's an elusiveness as to how successful we will be. I founded the National Center for African American Health Consciousness because I understood after all those years of work that as a collective community, we did not understand what was being said. Not that we were ignorant, but there are different ways that we understand the messages that are being delivered. And so I wanted to create the kind of atmosphere that would give us an opportunity to have conversations, to raise our level of consciousness so we could have the ability to make informed decisions about our health.
I'm Mark Belichick, and I am the health officer and director of the Genesee County Health Department. And full disclosure, my wife thought we should be a two-income family, but that she should stay home and raise our children. So I also am faculty at the University of Michigan in the public health program and at Michigan State University in the College of Human Medicine. I've really tried to build an academic health department on the local level. When I took over as health officer in 2009, my first assignment was to cut my budget by $2.5 million. It continued for the next 3 years, additional cuts. We went from $7 million in county general funds to support our work in the community to $1.8 million. I have 55 programs that I'm responsible for. Municipal water is not one of them, but it became my entire life because the agencies that were responsible for assuring that our municipal water was safe didn't do their job.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kent Key, and I am the director of the Office of Community Scholars and Practices at the Michigan State University College of Human Medicine, Division of Public Health. But I also have a community lens because I got my start in public health working through the community. I was an AmeriCorps member and alumni of the AmeriCorps program, and I'm currently the deputy director of the community-based organization Partners. So as a resident of Flint, born and raised there, I have two different perspectives. I have that research academic perspective, but I'm very, very rooted in my community perspective because that's how I evolved.
Good morning, my name is Lawrence Reynolds. I'm a Howard University graduate pediatrician, and I'm a general pediatrician. I'm also a senior, and I also live, work, and play in the city of Flint. And there was discussion earlier about being offended. And yes, I was offended and hurt when I saw the dismissive attitude and the negligence on the part of our city, state, and local government. And you should understand that until November, our city council, well, until January of this year, our city council and our mayor had no power, nor did the previous administration. We had a series of four emergency managers that had complete power over the city of Flint. And essentially their job was to cut the budget and cut the staff so that the budget would be balanced without any regard to public health, public safety, or what they would do in the case of an emergency or disaster.
Thank you all. So with that point, and one of the things that I had mentioned was about the fact that this could happen anywhere. And I think earlier in Brian's remarks, he talked about the idea of intentional and deliberate disinvestment. From your perspectives, what are the major takeaways? So there are a number of teams that are here that are going to be going back to their respective cities and tackling public health issues and infrastructure issues when they get home. What are the major lessons that you would give to others in cities that may experience a similar type of emergency? I know Mark and I have had conversations about what he learned from DC. I'd be very interested, and I'd really like for you all to share a little bit about what the key takeaways are in both the approach and that you had to bring to the table and how to navigate that lack of investment in that very complicated political landscape.
We had a 40% water loss or leakage rate. So you understand 40% of the water that came into the city of Flint, either from the Detroit source or from the new source, will leak out. So somebody has to pay for that. Now, I should add parenthetically, the other part was the citizens of Flint were accused of stealing water. Now, if you have a 40% leakage rate, what percentage of that was actually stolen? But when we talk about narrative, this was the narrative that was repeated continually. And then we had a water plant that ran 4 days a year as a backup source for Detroit-sourced water. So we had a plant that was antiquated, inadequate, and we had insufficient staff. And the staff themselves said, if it's up to us to pull the switch to make the change in water, we would not do this. And that message was lost.
In addition to the lost message, there was a real problem with communication. There were conversations going on about the water crisis at levels that never reached the people who were drinking and utilizing the water. We had for a number of years, and right now, pay the highest water rates. So some of the things that were missed in that conversation when you talk about stolen water was the fact that people's water were cut off because they couldn't pay the bill. We had a mission who was servicing residents in our community who could not take care of themselves, who could no longer provide services. So the community members began to rally and take water to them. They'd also hooked up some water so they could get it. In addition to that, you had conversations about not only with the high water rates, but people then, the water rates, if they were not paying their bills, the water was put on their taxes and they were losing their property because of the lien on the property. So there were a number of issues related to the water that people never understood even before the crisis hit. So that's what I mean by understanding the context of the community. If all of these elements are not understood, you can't fully address the problem. So then we're faced with the water switch, And when the water switches, community members immediately within the first couple of weeks said, something's wrong with this water. But nobody listened. Months went by. Nobody listened. And yet there were conversations at the federal, at the governmental level, at the city level, that never got to community. So we also wanted to create a space, and that's where part of my concern was, create a space for community members to hear what was going on so they could make better decisions for themselves. You can't make a decision that may be the best decision for you if you don't have the appropriate information to make that decision on.
Thank you, Yvonne. I wanted to underscore that portion because community members rallied and protest. There, a lot of the narrative that you saw in the media did not capture the totality of what happened in Flint. And a lot of that narrative, if you talk to many of the community members, is not a representation of Flint. There was a lot of grassroots movements. There was a lot of mobility and mobilization around protesting against the water that was not captured. But in this country, if we do not really own the fact that we have a historical disregard for community voice, and it's systemic. And so the community members were talking. They were, the voices were there, but they were, people were not listening, or those in power. And so it was not until data could back that people began to listen. So where do we're looking at changing and providing equity. And many of us are researchers or in positions or in activist organizations. When do we get to the point to where we don't have to have the data? And if folk are saying, I'm sick, something's wrong with me, something's happening, when do we move and as the earlier speaker says, take action? Or do we have to wait 3 or 4 months for somebody to collect some data? And so that's one of the lessons I've learned. Listen to the community, even if the data isn't there.
One of the lessons that I learned was we failed to learn the lessons from Washington, D.C., because this happened 10 years ago there. And Mark Edwards, a professor from Virginia Tech who discovered the lead problem in Washington, D.C., when he came to our town, the state government employees labeled him a troublemaker. They made the comment that he pulls a rabbit out of his hat wherever he goes. But he was the only one openly sharing his information with the community and with my department. The County Health Department had to FOIA both the City of Flint and the State Department of Environmental Quality to get information to help us, assist us in investigating what was going on in Flint. That lack of cooperation, that lack of openness in the process resulted in a delay in action, because public health has a tradition of being based upon research and data, and we make our decisions based upon that knowledge. And when you have roadblocks in acquiring it, it's devastating, especially for a population that knows by the color of that water, the taste, the odor, there's a problem.
And there was a series of collusion, I won't say conspiracy, but a series of collusion where people gamed the sample collection of water that was presented to the Department of Environmental Quality, or the samples that were excluded, so that the data that was presented to the public was what people wanted to see. So the question was this driven by providing clean, safe water to a community, or it was driven by economic development? Because in the course of our being under an emergency manager, we lost our two largest customers in the city of Flint. One was the rest of Genesee County that wasn't on well water, and the other was General Motors. And for those of you who may not know, General Motors stopped using Flint-sourced water when it started rusting the auto parts in the plant. Wow. However, when the citizens complained, and I say residents, because I always have to watch myself, because we have neighbors who are not citizens of the United States. But when residents complained, they were just blown off. And when residents who could not speak, because we have the largest deaf community in the state of Michigan, their needs were not met. So it was just a series of dismissive actions, negligent actions on the part of our government that were not addressed, and health was not primary.
I didn't give this history, but I actually lived in Flint in the 80s. My mom married a man from DC who hitchhiked to Flint when he was 19, because back then as a young man in DC, you either went to work for the government, and then there was all this promise and talk of all these jobs in Michigan, working for General Motors and in the factories. And so he lived here for a little bit over 40 years. And when I lived in Flint, Flint was about twice the size that it is now. And roughly the number of people that live in Flint now were employed by General Motors. Now the numbers are what? 7,000, around 7,000 people. And back then it was 80,000. And so it was a different city. The street that I lived on, there was not one vacant house. It was a thriving city. Now, we get pink slips every 3-4 months. I'm working in McDonald's. I have to compete with adults for hours when the labor stuff sort of turns around. And then I come back to Flint, you know, having left in the early 90s, and I come back as a resident myself, because I also now live in the city of Flint, you know, some 20 some odd years later. And half the blocks on the houses I grew up in are abandoned, where many of those factories sat, including one very close to my house, they're now just level properties. And so there are some key things that happened historically. The tax base in Flint shifted dramatically, right? Because the people who could afford to go, they left when the jobs left. Imagine you go from 80,000 jobs. This is like half the city works in one industry. And now that industry is gone. And then they've environmentally left whatever they've left behind. But the jobs are gone. So the people have also, many of them, left with those jobs. Why? Because they have to feed their families. So you talk about, we've talked a bit about this intentional divestment. But then there's also what happens when you have these real shifts, because the economy changes, labor changes, tax base shift in the city, and we know what happens naturally, sort of the natural course of what that does to a city unintervened. So then it's sort of the crime of omission, where we know if we don't act and bring in different approaches. And my colleague, Dr. Rick Sadler, is here, and he can better talk about this. But there are real approaches to how you then manage a city that way. So what happened is people started to treat Flint then as its own thing. It was fine when Flint was thriving and had 200,000 people and all those jobs, but now when we're down to a city of less than 100,000 and unemployment is through the roof, we need a different approach to how we manage taxes and allocation of resources. So that wasn't an intentional divestment. What it was is the historical divestment through things like redlining. What happens when General Motors and the others pulled out, and then people, knowing what needs to be done, then did not intervene? We have now lost a lot of our political will, which creates a context and a hotbed where things like the water crisis could actually take hold. That's why I think our work and us joining this collaborative is so important, because those are the kinds of tools and things that we need to bring to bear. If we had been addressing these issues, I think, better pre-water crisis, there wouldn't have been as much of a context for something like this to actually occur and persist for so long.
So on this piece of the narrative and creating the context, I want to dig into that a little bit more and think about the ways in which community can work to control their narrative. What is the role of storytelling? How do we take information that we're collecting from residents and use that to control the narrative? Because as someone who was not in Flint and was watching it on TV, I am sure that the portrayal was drastically different than what was actually happening. And the problem is that the resources that come from the federal level, the attention that this gets as it trickles up, is going to be based on that narrative. It's going to be connected intricately to that story. So Yvonne, I know you have a lot of thoughts on this, but how do communities work to control their own narrative?
Well, first of all, I think we have to recognize that the story was told wrong. I mean, I think we have to acknowledge that. So the community has to take a role in helping to right that kind of ship. And so that's part of what I'm gonna do right now. This story was painted as a poor, underserved, African-American issue. When you looked at the Time magazine cover story, it had a little black baby with rashes. When you look at some of the other stories that came out, National Geographic actually came in shortly after. Many of the community members didn't even know what was going on. They came in, they interviewed people, and in short order, there's a National Geographic story with pictures of people who are devastated. And it seemed like to me they just picked the worst kind of people they could ever find in a community to interview. When the fact of the matter is, the entire community was affected by this. Multi-generational, intergenerational, multiracial, multi-ethnic, academic, prepared, non-academic, whatever ABCDs, and if you don't have any DDs, everybody was affected. We have major people working with major academic institutions in all of these conversations, knowing what was going on. And right in the middle of the crisis, we're talking about all of this stuff. And I looked at them one day and I said, so what you doing about the water? And they looked at me and first hesitated and finally said, well, I'm still drinking my coffee with the city water. I'm still swimming every day. I'm still doing everything I'm doing. I said, well, what's wrong with you? Don't have a filter on your faucet? Because the conversation didn't seem to affect them because of the way the story was told. And so now we're looking at it as painted as a pediatric issue. And I do not at all discount the fact that children are adversely affected because of the developmental process. But everybody is affected. I'm a senior citizen. I raised three beautiful, smart children that's 30 in their 30s. I have no idea the impact of this on my life or my future. So nobody can be left out of the story. And that's part of what we need others help. I've said to folks at the highest levels of conversation, even the Surgeon General of the United States, this story has to be reframed. Because what happens when it isn't, the resources are adjusted. Some resources that could have come did not come. Some resources that came were allocated in ways that did not consider everybody in the community. We have senior citizens who are wondering, well, what's happening with me? And we're seeing senior citizens having health conditions that they never had before. People, adults, because we have a lot of data on children, we don't have a lot of data on adults as it relates to this. Adults who have never had blood pressure issues, one of the things we do know about high exposure to lead is it increases blood pressure, right? So I'm talking to really smart people. And I said, well, what do we do about this? And they looked at me and you said, no, you know, the last time I went to the doctor, my blood pressure was up. Not one time, but the last two times. So when we think of this only as one way to tell the story without looking at the total context of the community, and I do not disagree that there are some very egregious things that happened because they did not think people would stand up and speak out. If the residents of this community, and it was a multicultural endeavor, if the residents of the community had not spoken up, even from Mark Edwards, he said to us, the attention given to this superseded everything. After 4 years of this work in D.C., what we had done in a year expanded all of that work because people stood up. So I guess I'll end my comment by saying it is important to find ways that the community voice be heard. We put some things together working in partnership with the university, a water course, because when we couldn't get organizations that were in leadership to create platforms for community to have voice, the platform was created for community residents to be a part of a class, University of Michigan class, that was one created for students but open to community to actually come together, hear the health professionals, hear the EPA, the DEQ, and all of those folks talk about what it was and have an interaction so they could better understand what was going on. So how do we change the narrative? Now we got to keep talking. Now we got to write differently. We have to become more academically astute. We have to be in places that we typically were not invited to be in. And I don't suggest that we always, you know, sometimes you got to bogart, right? You just got to show up. But I suggest to our community, when we show up with the ammunition, we show up with the information and preparation to speak the voice. And I tell you right now, I don't speak for every person in the community because I have my own life experience. I share with you a perspective of community across cultures. I'm gonna stop. But she said I had a lot to say. But I will end there with this one thing. We work with communities because our concern is not just what happens now, but what happens beyond the water crisis. Because we gotta live with this. And how do we set up structures and embed things in our institutions, in our organizations that will live beyond us, that will ensure that the people who are coming along with us are actually able to do what we're doing when we're no longer in the position to do so.
Can I add a statement about the data that just piggybacks on what she said? I think it's so important, you know, and it was my first action lab, and I think it was in Boston. And I feel like I walked out of that meeting really entrenched in both the language of health equity. I had a much deeper understanding of some of the tools so we can actually uncover those things. And I think, because I know you, so the point that you were making about us showing up prepared and Kent's point about us actually having the data, I think is so important. Because we know the data by itself has not quite been enough. The community voice by itself has not quite been enough. But when all those factors came together, when Mark Edwards came and pulled his rabbit out of the hat, and when community people who had already been there, because there had already been people trying to put some data out there. There had been community people trying to put the voice out there, but when these things came together, I think it was really critical. And I do think as a group and as a team of people trying to really do that work, it would absolutely serve us to stay on top of the data of it, to bring to bear the language and the resources and the practices and the framing of health equity so that we don't have the same narrative, but we are bringing to bear the best resources and skills and tools so that we can change the narrative with real backing behind it. And there are real tools in this field on how to do that.
Thank you. Turning a little bit to government for a second. The role of public health, and you touched on this a little bit, this particular event was challenging in part because it had this environmental context that you did not have powers to have light into. And what we know is that there are going to be, for years and years to come, public health impacts for this community, some of which we don't even know yet. Could you shed a little bit of light from your perspective about how public health has to engage and public health departments have to engage with other parts of government that are intrinsically connected to community health? Can you share some light on that?
Well, one of the things you need to understand about the state of Michigan is we actually don't have a state public health department. We used to when I first started in public health a couple decades ago. But over a number of administrations, the programs that were in the Department of Public Health got shifted into four different agencies of state government. So water regulation now on the municipal level is in the Department of Environmental Quality. And they're very much engineering focused. The lead copper standard is not a health standard. It's an engineering standard. All of you need to understand this. It's based upon a mathematical model. It doesn't protect health. It allows for 15 parts per billion in lead on average over samples that are supposed to look at what are suspected to be the highest levels in your community. As Dr. Reynolds said, they fudged the data in Flint to meet that standard. But in your community, what that means is that up to 10% of your population could be drinking hazardous lead. And imagine if that's a mom that's gone home from your WIC program with powdered formula and what that's doing to a developing infant. We need to do a better job. Public health cannot be silent. We have to educate the population about these things. Municipal waters are required to send out to all their customers a statement saying that the water is safe, or that if there's a problem, identify what it is. But what you have to understand, because the lead standard is an engineering standard, it does not mean that everyone is safe. It's an average.
And data can be used in a deceitful fashion. And I have to be totally clear on that, because when we're talking about a city of Flint that has discrete boundaries, maybe 300 non-Flint residents use Flint water. And so they will say, okay, let's release our data by zip code. Well, the zip codes overlap the city boundaries. So that dilutes the sample that you're working with. And then they say, okay, let's look by political ward. And see, lead in water didn't respect those artificial man-made boundaries. So our local researchers had to use the nuclear option. Dr. Sadler over there did his GIS data mapping, which showed clusters. And back to Mark's point, 10% can have lead levels, 10% of the water samples can have lead levels over 15 parts per billion. Where are those 10% located? Are they scattered randomly and evenly throughout the city, or are they clustered? And now we're getting to the heart of infrastructure issues, environmental justice, and environmental racism. And understand that this whole thing was done to save $5 million.
$5 million, okay. So I'm an emergency planner. I think about disasters daily, in part because we tend to not think about disasters and emergencies until they happen. One of the things that is very clear in the public health landscape, in the community landscape, is that we're really busy doing a lot of other things. There are a lot of things that we have to focus on to deal with life-sustaining matters that are non-disaster related. And then you add this layer of emergency preparedness and thinking about all of the potential vulnerabilities and the what ifs. What are your thoughts on how we integrate that, integrate emergency preparedness into our public health conversation without increasing the burden? I heard a whoa, so that might be a good one. I don't know.
One of the things that we've had conversations with in our community, and I've done a lot of work with our health department, so I had this conversation with our previous health officer about developing the emergency preparedness plan for the county. And so one day in the conversation, I said, so when are you going to tell the community about this plan? Because when the emergency hits, whoever is closest to me is the first responder. We had situations where we had a chemical exposure because of a train derailment. People didn't call the health department first. They ran to the church to have a place to go that was a distance from where that happened. So to integrate the conversation about preparedness, it must be a conversation with people. How do we, no matter how wonderful that plan is that you've developed and is sitting in your office, and when the disaster hits, you say, okay, let's go do ABC 1, 2, 3. This is what happened when the federal government declared an emergency for Flint. And that's why I so emphasize this contextual kind of conversation about what's going on in the community, because they came. They have a really, really wonderful Red Cross plan that works all over the world. They pull their little groups together and they get together and they talk about what we need to do next, but they never talk to me or you. And so when the plan is finished, by the time they get through coming out of the room with the plan, we've already created an emergency response, which may conflict with their response. But it is what we've known to do to be as safe as we can be in the time of the crisis. So if we don't have these conversations pre-crisis, it's not going to happen in the crisis in the way that our nice, neat little packages
have all been put together. Also with that, to underscore that, community must be at the table. My grandfather used to say all the time, you better make sure that you're at the table, because if you're not at the table, you might be on the table. And so when we talk about response plans, if community is not integrated in that, then there's going to be trouble down the road. For example, when the state came in, they were putting up water stations in front of fire stations. Well, what's going to happen if the fire break out? You got all these cars double lined in front of the fire station. Then they were, and if you had to talk to community, because community members were like, this is dumb. Just simple things like that. When they were taking the state police were going around, and the sheriff going around, going through neighborhoods delivering water. First of all, we know what the climate is right now with communities of color and policing. People are not going to open up their door. Don't nobody want to see the popo, that's slang for police, coming down their neighborhood. And then we had a Hispanic population who don't want to see the police coming up. They don't want to be deported. You know, all those stories about ICE looking to go to the Hispanic parts of Flint, they were going to deport people. These were things that were happening. Also on that response of people, if the community had been engaged, then the Hispanic population would have been able to be at the table and a part of that process. Many of them didn't even know the water was bad in Flint until members of their family in their countries of origin were calling them, telling them not to drink the water. So if we do not engage community in a response, is it really a response plan, or is it just someone telling us what they think we ought to do?
And had it not been for the nonprofit and community organizations and the faith community, and I say faith community because we had members from the local Islamic places of worship distributing water that were trusted more than the state police rolling down the street. Okay, and for 3 months, community organizations and coalitions, the United Way, the Food Bank, coordinating with the churches, distributed water and filters. And then the universities came on board. So for 3 months, while the feds and the state and the county dickered over, is this an emergency? Is a man-made situation a disaster, or is it an emergency? The community met those needs. And so there were networks, and there are networks that are developing. If you had told me that twice a week I talk to a mechanical engineer from our local Kettering University so she can interpret information for me, I would have laughed at you 5 years ago. But this is what we had to do. And so we developed these networks. They were almost organic. And then we reached a critical mass to push our city, county, and state and federal government to do something. So this is a process, but it depends on that social capital that you have, the connections that you have. And I really would like to reinforce Yvonne's point about this was displayed as a black low-income city. And I'm looking around at my neighbors and my friends and saying, yeah, we have a high poverty rate. Yeah, we have low income. But the city of Flint is actually about 40% white. So give me a break. And we were working together. So there was always this attempt to divide the community.
I just wanted to underscore one thing that you mentioned when you talked about man-made disaster. That was a big narrative that we were pushing, because this was not a natural disaster. This was something that was created by a decision of humans, of a man. We know who his name is, right? And so when there is a man-made disaster that could have been avoidable, and the parties in charge or that created it are in a position over the people that are suffered, it creates a whole nother level of psychological trauma. In a natural disaster, it's still a disaster, it's still hurt, there's still trauma. But there's some type of resolve where we couldn't avoid the tornado. No one could have really stopped the tornado from coming. But when it's a man-made disaster, there's a whole nother level of distrust. And there is the trust issues in Flint, I mean, it's unexplainable, and rightfully so. People are not trusting any level of government at all. And the faith-based leaders I'm seeing are really becoming the health communications officer for many, because people are not trusting anyone in any level of government, but they'll go to their rabbi or to their priest or to the leader of their mosque and ask for information, which now puts those faith leaders in a different situation. Some may have participated in some research in the past, but many of them may have not and have never had to stand in the role of a health communications officer. And they don't necessarily know all of those things. So when we look at this and we think about the levels of mistrust, and we think about the whole man-made disaster versus a natural disaster, there are so many other levels of responding, not just to the water itself, but to the psychological trauma that is happening to the residents that we need to also have as part of that response plan.
I'm now going to open up the floor for questions. There's one microphone right here. If any of you have questions, I invite you to the mic.
My name is Peter Hammer. I direct the Damon J. Key Center for Civil Rights at Wayne State Law School, and I want to thank you all for your good work in Flint. One notion I'd like to put in the room is the need to be more intentional about the convergence of civil rights and public health under a self-conscious methodology of structural racism. I really believe that public health can play as much of an important role in our generation's civil rights struggle as the courts played in the first civil rights movement. To that extent, I'd like to lift up the work of the Michigan Civil Rights Commission that is actually holding hearings on the Flint water crisis from a perspective of civil rights and structural racism. And as a point of information, say that I've released a report over the summer looking at the issue, framing it from a position of structural and strategic racism, addressing at very great length the notion that this really is a man-made disaster. So I'd ask you, if you think about the merger between civil rights and public health and using Flint as a case study, what are some of the thoughts that you might have about how we move forward?
I have to jump in real quick. I'm gonna say something brief. I'm actually bringing a very good colleague of mine here. Her name's Deborah Small. She's an attorney. She used to be the chief counsel for the Drug Policy Alliance. She has raised the issue just from a public health perspective. We know the long-term, for example, impacts of early lead exposure. So what's predictable, and don't get me wrong, Flint is mounting, like, all pulling out all the stops, doing everything we can to provide as much for, there's a big emphasis and a push for pediatric populations, and there are those among us rallying for the geriatric population and just adults in general. But we know for a fact that there are kids who were literally born and raised on Flint water. They've been exposed to it from conception and into their early infancy. There is clear data. We know what that the impacts that that has on cognitive development, later executive functioning, decision making. Predictably, those kids will be at greater risk for some behavioral, psychosocial, and some health problems down the line. And again, we're doing what we can to undo that, but that is what is predictable. Now, what happens when those same kids, we learned this in Baltimore, what happens when those same kids are 14? They have earlier sexual debut, they are more involved in other types of behavior, substance use, more likely to be victims and or perpetrators of violence. What about those same kids that are growing up in the face of other structural risk factors? We will not remember that this man-made disaster was imposed on them in utero that they had no say over, and their moms were lied to about the risk. And we will absolutely look at those kids and hold them to account for every bad decision that they make, every crime they commit, every failure that they have. There's no legal precedent for this, but there is some possibility for statutes, for some presumptions to be made about those kids as they then become the kids that may potentially enter our criminal justice system into the future. There is a lot that can be done legally for what's happening in Flint, and it's not just about right now. We literally have to be thinking long range with some of this stuff.
To the gentleman who just spoke, I want to thank you for authoring that monograph. It was timely and it was helpful. And maybe we ought to expand the paradigm slightly. Is safe, clean water a human right, a civil right, or will it be a commodity?
Next question.
Good morning. My name is Jim Bloyd. I'm the regional health officer at the Cook County Department of Public Health in Cook County, Illinois. I was extremely troubled. I thought I knew what was happening in Flint until I attended the recent APHA meeting in Denver, where I heard Yana Lambrinidou and Jennifer Carrera speak and others. And I think it's extremely important for leadership at local government, health departments, and other levels to understand and wrestle with these issues ourselves, regardless of whether water is under our purview and our jurisdiction, because of what you mentioned about what happened in Washington, D.C., and how CDC's report on the results of that had to be redrafted. They took it back. Before I ask my question, I'm concerned about the intersections of the history of genocide against American indigenous populations, where fracking is threatening the water of my brothers and sisters in Farmington, in New Mexico, and other places, and where water potential poisoning is still in existence for Black folks and white folks and other folks in our jurisdiction now. So I think what's happening at the Dakota Access Pipeline and what's happening in Flint or what might be happening in Ford Heights, Illinois, or Harvey, Illinois, these are important intersections of issues about power and politics and structural racism and the history. What are we going to be doing about it as governmental public health leaders or nonprofit or academics? Listening to those community voices. I think community voices are data. People's experiences are important. So my question is involving it's my understanding, and I'm wondering if this is true, the issue of state austerity, the issue of intentionally defunding Black municipalities through cuts in revenue sharing, which then pushes people into this loss of democracy and loss of sovereignty, into this emergency manager situation. Governor Rauner in the state of Illinois is practicing and following that path right now. And I fear that unless me and my colleagues at the state level in Illinois speak up for public health programs, we will lose our state health department. So my question is about this way upstream structural racism in revenue sharing and this emergency. Is that true that that happened?
Definitely that happened. You know, historically, communities in Appalachia, communities, Black and brown communities, are used to small government. For us, small government meant no drainage ditches, no clean water supply, no schools, no library. So this is not something new. It's just been repackaged, and we have accepted it. The other story out there is we ought to run government like a corporation. Well, democracy is not a corporation. Government providing essential services is not easy and not always efficient. Imagine if someone said, we won't deliver mail to your neighborhood because the houses are too far apart. Well, that's the thinking that running government like a corporation will lead you to. Or we don't need our health department speaking up because they're interfering with economic development. That benefits whom? And, you know, just as part of being out here in this water battle, I met a physician from Durango, Colorado, where a retention pool broke and spilled water into the river. That is going to the Four Corners area of where a large Navajo population lives. These things are not accidental, this disregard. And I've heard other environmental people, justice people talk about, are there sacrifice zones? Just like when there was mining for uranium, where the Navajo and Native American reservations out west, where the uranium was, were they given up and exposed to radioactive material as a sacrifice zone? Will our communities become sacrifice zones for economic development where the benefits and the risks are not shared equally?
So we are very low on time, so I'm going to ask that the first two people there, could you just ask your question? And we'll try to cover those two in the minute and a half that we have.
Okay, I'll be very brief. I think I can do this in 30 seconds. My name is Michelle George. I'm a public health nurse and also a care coordination nurse. I'm in the field of HIV as well. I know as the Flint water, we were involved with the United Nations came to Detroit. That's when I first heard the testimonies of some of the Flint residents. And I was helping a young lady in Flint who was losing her hair, her teeth was falling out. And as a nurse, I was asked to speak in front of the Michigan State Legislature. But what I couldn't understand when we were in the state capitol and the governor was upstairs, I'm like, why didn't anyone know of this? Also, when I was, so what I decided to do, I collected 20 signatures from that United Nations summit and I sent it to the EPA Region 5 in Chicago. I did get a response, but at the time her comment was, and I won't name because I was at the governor's hearing in DC, the judiciary hearing. He mentioned her name, and she stated that, I'm getting all these calls from Flint. They're hollering in my face, and I told her, this is why they're hollering. But at the time, I was fighting the TTHM that was in the water, the trihalomethane. As it went on, she said, Ms. George, your letter did help. And I did speak to someone in the Michigan Department of Quality who's being now indicted. My comment, and I also sent information, I said I had spoke with a certain person in the Michigan Department of Quality Water, but I was fighting with the TTHM, and I said that one person is being indicted. And I was just speaking about this was going on in Flint. Ms. George, the water's safe, but I said, that's okay, the Lord will expose what's happening. But I also put together packages. Joe Madison, the poet, she said, ask my question. My comment was, and I'm just trying to give a background, but when I was in a Congressional Black Caucus in September, I asked Representative Neely, what can we do as nurses? And he was just telling me that we need a hotline. I need to connect with somebody so we can get that hotline going. That's my question, and where you think on that. Okay. Thank you.
And the next question, please.
I want to ask you a question about trust. Trust is, I firmly believe, earned, not given. I also don't want people in the audience to think we don't have state health department leadership. Just to clarify Mark's point, we have a Department of Health and Human Services, which includes public health, Medicaid, and human services. So I don't want people to think Michigan doesn't have state public health. But it's the misunderstanding of messages that damages trust. And so I just want to hear what you've done at the local level to earn the trust of the communities, and what has the community done to be open to reestablishing trust?
So, whoever would like to take those two.
Well, I think it's being out in community and answering the questions that the population has. It's being open with the information that you do have. It's telling your story. Because I teach a course in the medical school, and one of the assignments I give my students, it's called, Who Are You Gonna Call? Okay, and it's 30 different scenarios that I've received as health officer from the public who perceives a public health problem. Of those 30, only 10 are things that I have jurisdiction and authority over. Other agencies cover the other 20 items. The population doesn't understand that. And it's even difficult within public health to understand who's doing what, because with each election cycle, a new governor in our state has moved programs around from one agency to another. And whereas we do have a Michigan Department of Health and Human Services, it's basically a big insurance agency focused on cost cutting. much more so than on public health.
From a community side, creating forums and opportunities for community members to be in the presence of and in dialogue with those who are in the agencies cannot happen without that dialogue. Cannot rebuild trust unless I can look at you in your face and ask you the questions that I don't understand, and then you be honest and transparent and give me those answers. Now, I don't know if you are or not, but we create that space. And the other thing is including all the voices. I understand all of these programs to deal with my child, but if you don't deal with me, you can't get to my baby. So we need to figure out how to ensure that the parents who are responsible for the children, the parents who are buying on, we talk about, and it was said earlier in the first panel, place does matter, zip code does matter, but that baby didn't move itself. And if we don't help the parents understand what's available to them so they're in a better place to make quality decisions for on behalf of their children, we will continue to see generations of unmet needs. This is so historic. That's why I said history matters. History matters. If we don't look back and see what happened in the past and determine what we're going to be doing differently today so that the past isn't repeated, we will see the same thing again. So I encourage us, let's not dismiss the history as if it didn't happen, because it did. But what will we do differently? How will we bring people into the conversation that was not a part of the conversation? How will we elevate their level of understanding so that they can speak effectively? But more importantly, not just so that they can speak effectively, but that we can hear effectively.
And on that very powerful note, I would like to thank all of my panelists. You all have done a wonderful job explaining the issue and explaining what the next steps are. I believe that this is the beginning of a conversation. And so as we all can support you all in the work that you continue to do, we look forward to doing that. Thank you.